So before I hand things over to Lou, so just a brief introduction here. So good evening, everyone. My name is Hillary Potts, and I work in the MSW field office at Laurier in the Faculty of Social Work. And I'd like to welcome you to this evening's session. A big thank you to the Waterloo Region Community Legal Services for their time and expertise in delivering these sessions throughout the month of February. If you have any questions about registering for the events, whether you've registered for more than one or you can't remember, any questions at all, please reach me directly at mswfield@wlu.ca and we'll get things sorted out. So let's first acknowledge the land in which we are situated. The Faculty of Social Work is on Laurier's Kitchener campus, and that's where I am too this evening, Kitchener, Ontario. The downtown area, to be specific. Laurier is on the traditional territory of the Neutral, Anishinaabe, and Haudenosaunee peoples. And this is very relevant to our session this evening as well. So I believe we'll be exploring all sorts of things along this theme. I wish everyone a wonderful and insightful session this evening. I'd like to now hand it over to our speaker, Lou Roberts, but first say a few introductory words about our speaker. So Lou Roberts, Sturgeon Clan, is a member of the Sandy Lake First Nation and grew up in Kenora, Ontario. Lou has lived in the Waterloo region since 2005, if I'm getting that right, attending the University of Waterloo and obtaining her BA in psychology. Lou then attended Laurier and received her master's in social work, so we're in good company here, and worked as the Waterloo Aboriginal Education Center coordinator for 6 years before transitioning to the Indigenous Justice Coordinator role at the Waterloo Region Community Legal Services, where Lou assists Indigenous people in navigating the legal system. So welcome, Lou. Lou is a passionate advocate for Indigenous rights, and I'll turn it over to you now. Thanks very much.
Thank you, Hillary. I'm also going to do an introduction in the language. So, Buju, Inimkikwe, Nindijinakos, Name Nidodem. Kenora and Niga Zaga Iganing Nitam Anishinaabe Ninduchaba Kitchenerandayan. So I wanted to introduce myself in the language because I feel it's important as an act of reclamation of what was lost. So my mom is a residential school survivor. She went to Cecilia Jeffrey Residential School in Kenora, which if you have no some of the stories about residential school, there was a little boy named Cheney Wenjack who passed away after running away from the residential school trying to get home. So if you heard of Cheney Wenjack, that's the same residential school that my mom went to. My mom survived and she's still living today, but the trauma around it still persists. Also, I would like to start with a smudge as well. So I am going to do a smudge. And if you have smudge yourself or if you wanted to follow along, by all means. So I have a little bowl here. Oh, my flame went out. And I'm smudging with sage. And I always like to smudge before a meeting to kind of set the intention in a good way. All right, so I have it lit. So I smudge to start the meeting as a gathering in a good way. It's to center ourselves, and the smudge cleanses our bodies to rid ourselves of any negative energy that we may have picked up throughout the day. So first, I wash the smoke, and I'm using sage, over my head. And I smudge my ears to hear good thoughts, or to hear good words. I smudge my eyes to see good things. I smudge my mouth to speak good words and to speak positive about others. And I smudge my heart so I will portray the good part of myself through actions. And so smudging is a part of what is called Nino Benatsuin, living the good life. And I would also like to thank Hillary for doing a territorial acknowledgement, land acknowledgement. I also wanted to say too that, you know, this isn't my territory. I am also a visitor of this territory. So I like to thank all those before me and ancestors for allowing me to do the good work here. And I have a colleague, Angie, who is helping to monitor the chat. So if you do have any questions throughout my presentation, by all means, you can ask them. And if you put them in the chat, then Angie, you can assist in just, I can't see the chat with this, so. Thank you. So, all right. I'm just going to go over a little bit of just general information. I know that this is a social work class, so you may have been exposed to a number of terms and some of Indigenous teachings, but I just want to make sure that, you know, we're at the same kind of knowledge and background. So what terms I use? So I will use Indigenous or Aboriginal, First Peoples interchangeably. And then there's also terms like First Nation, Métis, and Inuit, which is the umbrella term underneath Indigenous and Aboriginal and First Peoples. That's the umbrella term that encompasses all, right? So like First Nation includes status and non-status people, status being people that are registered under the Indian Act. So the First Peoples of this land, now known as Canada or known as Turtle Island, formerly had unique communities with unique names. There wasn't a need for collective nouns or complicated terminology. So with European contact and the ensuing colonization, the government required people to be defined and labeled for ease of governing. So what? So the terms that I use, it can depend on the context. If you're unsure about what terms to use, it's okay to ask. So for myself, I refer to myself as Cree or Mishkigawak. My mom growing up always referred to us as being Cree. The community that I come from is what I know it as Oja Cree. So there's a lot of Ojibwe or Cree people. And of course we intermix and mingle with each other, right? Mishkigawak is another term. I know it as in English term as Swampy Cree. So that's different than, you know, the different kind, there are different kinds of Cree such as Plains Cree and whatnot. So I was always taught that we were the Swampy Cree. And then there's another term that I just wanted to touch on is the term Indian. So that definitely isn't used as the umbrella term or as the preferred term. However, there are situations where that term could be appropriate. For example, the Indian Act or the Indian residential schools. So the term is still used in those contexts and you're using Indian as a legal identity. Oh, I see a chat question. Oh, okay. Thanks, Angie.
No problem.
All right. So I'm just gonna go to the next slide. Hopefully it'll go. Okay, so I'm just going to talk very briefly about treaties. Treaties can be a whole other presentation on its own, so I'm just going to touch a little bit briefly about it. So treaties, what are they? It's basically a mutual agreement between nations defining their relationship and how that relationship is conducted. So we're currently on the Haldimand Tract and the Haldimand Treaty, but also the Between the Lakes Treaty. As people living in Kitchener-Waterloo, Ontario, we are all treaty people. And so we need to know what our treaty rights and responsibilities are. Sorry, hold on a second. Dude, you gotta leave. Okay, but sorry about that, guys. That's the life of when you have children and presenting at dinner time. So I'm just gonna just give me a minute, dude. You gotta go, okay? Yeah. Okay. right. Okay, so with the treaties, the first one that is on the image there is the Dish with One Spoon Treaty. So that was pre-contact. So it was the treaty that was negotiated between the Anishinaabe and the Haudenosaunee, and it was for shared hunting ground agreements. So the dish in the middle, the purple in the middle, that represented the dish, which was the shared hunting grounds and the sharing of resources. And there's also the spoon. So that was the sharing of resources. That would be the collective responsibility of sharing that and not causing bloodshed or war, and having that collective responsibility. The middle photo is the Two Row Wampum. So that was the first treaty with the Europeans. So that was between the Dutch and the Haudenosaunee. And I just wanted to quote passage on the meaning of it. So I quote, "We will not be like father and son, but like brothers. Our treaties symbolize two paths or two vessels traveling down the same river together." So the white, it symbolizes the river, with the purple symbolizing the two vessels. One, a birch bark canoe, will be for the indigenous people, their laws, customs, and their ways. The other, a ship, will be for the white people and their laws, customs, and ways. We shall each travel the river together side by side, but in our own boat. Neither of us will make compulsory laws nor interfere with the internal affairs of the other. Neither of us will try to steer each other's vessel. And so with the first part of the quote, where it says, "We will not be like father and son," the Dutch really wanted that relationship to be that way, like father and son. So they would be like father and son, but it was not agreed to. And so it was determined that they would not interfere with each other's laws, rules, and customs. However, we know from history and the events leading up today that that treaty was broken. So the other treaty, the third one down below, is another really important one. So that's the Treaty of Niagara in 1764. And so that that treaty solidified the acceptance of the Royal Proclamation of 1763. So the Treaty of Niagara was entered into with a number of different nations, and those of the settlers at the time. So it basically, so if you wanted to do some more information or research around the Royal Proclamation, there's tons of information. I really don't want to get into that because it is so extensive, but it is one of the ones that is very relevant to this area. All right. So I wanted to try and do a little exercise. So I will have to stop sharing the screen. Angie, are you able to put the link in the chat? So yep. It's an exercise called "What is Normal?" Oh, yes. So you can click on the link. And so I will explain a little bit about what to do. So I'm just going to stop sharing here for a minute. All right, see if I can, I might have to share the screen again and reshare it. Okay, so here it is, share. Okay, so I have two circles and I have different stickies for each of the sections of the circle. So the one in the middle here, can everybody see it? Hopefully everybody can see it, yeah, and there's no issues. If you have any issues, just let me know or put something in chat. Okay, so the sticky note here, there's a bunch of them. If you need to add more, you can go to this little icon here. So based on our current society now, thinking of the current context of being in Canada, today's society, what is normalized in our society? So for example, I'll give an example right now of the nuclear family. So having, a parent, male, father, mother, 2 point whatever children. It didn't show up, did it? Oh, that's strange.
Oh, there it is.
Okay, it just took a minute for me. So if you want to grab a sticky note and then add your thought of what is considered normal in our society, I can give some other examples if you're stumped. So things like having westernized education, so going to post-secondary a post-secondary institution to get educated, having money. Oh, I have one here that's heterosexuality. Yeah. Retirement at a certain age, for sure. Even what is valued in our society now. So, ageism, right? If you think of that. So being between the ages of 18 and, 50 or something, right? So that's another example of what is valued or what is considered normal in our society. Being white is highly valued, being male, being cisgendered, all of those are potential options. I'll just give you a minute to participate. I have a really good one here, living in a house. Yeah, for sure. Yes, having an intimate relationship, definitely what is valued and what is strived for. Having your own home by your mid-20s with money and a family, yep. Having personal possessions, definitely. I don't know if there's any more sticky notes, if I can add another one. Oh, did I just duplicate that and delete that? Starting at the bottom in a job and working your way up or creating your own business. Yeah, so I think that can even be interpreted as being successful or having success, right? Making a name for yourself, being famous, I guess, or having some sort of notoriety. So yeah, that's definitely all great. Great suggestions. So in the outer ring, in the blue sticky notes, and I can add some more sticky notes too. So things that may be considered not normal or abnormal in our society. I can give an example of, having a mental health diagnosis. Such as depression or schizophrenia. Being a single wealthy woman. Well, yeah, I guess that could be one, but wealth would maybe be determined as something that people would strive towards, right? But being a single woman could potentially be one. Being a single mother, that often has stigma or may be considered abnormal for some. Being neurodivergent, for sure. Living alone, yeah. That's great. Having a history of incarceration, most definitely. Mm-hmm. Even things like having a physical disability, using mobility aids, being introverted, yes, definitely. I'll just give a minute for anybody else to add some. So other ones that even just some terms, right, of what's considered abnormal is being stigmatized, having an addiction, being homeless, perhaps, being oppressed, or even in our Canadian context, right, having a darker skin tone, skin color. So the race often could determine, you know, what is acceptable or not acceptable in some people's eyes. And I don't want to generalize too, right? Because I know there's a lot of great people that definitely don't think of those as being not normal or abnormal, but things that we strive towards are things that we see in our society as being thought of as, not normal or, yeah. So there's another one, identifying as two spirit. And as much as I don't want to talk about the convoy that's been happening, you know, there's a lot of undertones of white supremacy and whatnot. Or even in Quebec, when the legislation came out of not having religious symbols for public servants or people that work in the public service, right? But that was more targeted towards people wearing, you know, the hijab, for example. So another potential is having a different religion other than Christianity. Yeah, these are all PTSD diagnosis, definitely. So one thing that I want to ask, I guess, is so what is the solution towards or to being abnormal? So oftentimes when I do this activity, I put in a bunch of arrows that go towards the middle, right? So there are treatments towards the norm. So what treatments are used to move closer to that norm? If you want to unmute yourself and just say something, that's fine. If you wanted to type it in the chat. Think about areas of justice or areas of health and mental health. What are those, some of those treatments to, or solutions towards the norm? Moving away from what is not normal. I can definitely think of, you know, being a social worker, right? There are some therapeutic treatments that try to assist, I guess, in things like mental health, right? Medication to try and treat those. The history of incarceration. So what's the purpose of incarceration? Is it to try and rehabilitate or, using those punitive methods, right? Is that a treatment towards a norm? Does anybody have any ideas of what a potential other term is in regards to the solution to what is not normal or abnormal? So the question is, can anybody think of another term that we may use either now or historically? Angie, did you want to take a shot at it?
Someone in the chat actually said othering.
Yeah, for sure. There is a specific term I am thinking about, and it'll make sense. Based on what I'm going to talk about next. But yes, othering for sure. Othering is definitely something, but what would be considered, so the treatment towards the norm. So what could that be another term used? So thinking about it in the Indigenous context, what are some of the things that were done to Indigenous peoples? In order to fit into society, into the Canadian, I guess, context or the colonial context.
Assimilation. Yeah, someone said the same.
Assimilation. That is right. Yeah, assimilation. I heard a whole bunch of people say it all at once. Assimilation for sure, definitely. So I think that a lot of policies, I guess, policies, even legislation, right, that is attempting to assimilate into our Canadian context, even today. So I'm going to stop sharing this. So thank you so much for doing this. This is like the second time that I've tried doing this over Zoom. So thank you for participating. So I'm going to go back to my presentation. I have two of them. Sorry, just a minute. I have two and now I don't know which one's which. It's this one. Okay. Yeah, so I have, just give me a second. Can everybody see that?
We can't see your screen yet, Lou.
Oh, that's strange. Okay, hold on. Well, I don't know what happened. Okay, so. Is that better?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. And I will just put it in presentation mode. Okay, so just in case it didn't work, I just put in one that I had written. So, I mean, there's other ones too, right? Like that I have in here, able-bodied, attractive, between the age of 19 and 60, speaking English, being sane, heterosexual, cis, male, educated. So like the westernized education, being independent, having money, being white, and then I'll leave ones on the outside. So what is out of the realm of normal, being labeled as crazy, oppressed, ugly, invisible, targeted, addicted, stigmatized, discriminated, poor, disabled, being labeled as a problem. So when I do this exercise, it's always a little bit different too, right? I think I had copied this from another one that I had done with another group. All right. So like I said, there was a reason behind that. And I just kind of wanted to bring it to the whole assimilation, right? So the Indian Act is a legislated act that is obviously still in today's legislation. But the original policy goal was to assimilate. So it was, it began the British Parliamentary Papers of 1834. So for the Indian Act, the policy goal was eventually relieving His Majesty's government from the expense of the Indian Department. So the objective was to collect the Indians in considerable numbers and to settle them in villages with due portion of land for their cultivation and support. So the Indian Act, Indians were viewed as children or wards of the state in which the government had a paternalistic duty to protect and civilize. And I want to quote this from a person from the past. So I'll quote this. When the school is on the reserve, the child lives with its parents, who are savages. And though he may learn to read and write, his habits and training mode of thought are Indian. He is simply a savage who can read and write. It has been strongly impressed upon myself as head of the department that Indian children should be withdrawn as much as possible from the parental influence. And the only way to do that would be to put them in central training industrial schools where they will acquire the habits and modes of thought of white men. Can anybody take a guess on who said that? Any guesses on who said that? So essentially saying
Ryerson?
Not Ryerson. So I see in the chat here, MacDonald. So yes, it was our very own Sir John A. MacDonald, the Prime Minister of Canada. So when I know there's a lot of conversation around Sir John A. Macdonald in our community right now, there is a process of renaming a high school. So 650 Laurelwood is what it's called now, but you know, it's undergoing the process of renaming. And you know, there's a lot of discussion around the harms that, you know, have been done and the reason why, you know, we want the name change. So you know, there's lots of arguments on either side, and you know, the other side say, well, is it, you know, erasing history and not whatnot? And you know, like my response is, well, no, it's not erasing history, but it's not celebrating that person. So to have statues of people like Sir John A. Macdonald or even Ryerson, like you said, Angie, you know, it's to actually kind of redefine the narrative that that, you know, these people were great, and you know, showing what actually Canada was built upon, and it was the assimilation and destruction of Indigenous peoples, the genocide of Indigenous peoples. So I mean, there's a lot. Yeah, so there's another quote here, and I'll say, like, so it's from Duncan Campbell Scott, who was another one that was a huge player in the creation of residential schools. So here, I'll quote this. So it is readily acknowledged that Indian children lose their natural resistance to illness by habitating so closely in these schools, and that they die at a much higher rate than in their villages. But this alone does not justify a change in the policy of this department, which is being geared towards the final solution of the Indian problem. So that was Duncan Campbell Scott. So acknowledging that, you know, there are tests that are occurring in residential schools, and we know this, right? The media just recently, I guess within the last year, started covering this, but as Indigenous peoples, we've known this, right? From when it very first started. Like I said, my mom is a residential school survivor, and I grew up not too far away from where she went to school. And I remember I was about, I don't know, 18 or 19 at the time, visiting that area, which was offices now for the Treaty 3 band or department. And so I remember talking to someone and them pointing in a particular direction, saying, those are where the grave sites are. I mean, they're not marked, but we know that's where they are. To have those graves, and they were unmarked. So, you know, none of the graves are marked. I mean, there's tons of testimony from the TRC that told about the deaths and the abuse that occurred, right, and that led to deaths. So knowing, you know, like we've always known this, and it's always been talked about, but just recently the media covered it, and you know, it started with resident, like the reserves and the residential schools with the grave sites. And actually just today there's another reserve. So it's KC Coast First Nation. They have found 54 potential grave sites at two of their residential schools. But I also like to mention too that yes, this was something that was really covered in May, June of last year, but a lot of the ones that are now coming out, so there's another one in Williams Lake First Nations that have found 93, it's barely being covered by the media now, and it doesn't have the coverage that it once does. Now I know it's competing with things like the convoy and COVID. However, I mean, this is stuff that's still happening, and I think we should really still be talking about this and realizing that there are going to be more. I don't even know what number. I know we're in the thousands of children that have died at residential schools, and I've heard of a number of different quotes of how many children died, and just know that it's a lot, in the thousands, in tens of thousands perhaps. And talking about historical and contemporary issues, right? So things like the recovery of grave sites in residential schools, missing murdered Indigenous women and girls, the increased incarceration rates of Indigenous peoples, or even the increased rates of children in foster care. So I don't know if you've heard of statistics, right, of there being more children in foster care now than there ever were at residential school. That's something that was quoted by Cindy Blackstock through the First Nations Child and Family Caring Society. So things like the prisons and foster care is essentially the new residential school. So these assimilation tactics and these genocidal actions are still happening today. So I just want to make that point clear that this isn't something that's happened in the past, and it's continuing and it's ongoing. The colonial destruction and assimilation and genocide of Indigenous peoples are still happening today. I just wanted to go back, it's something that I saw today, even with the convoy, the trucker convoy, and like I said, I hate to talk about this, but even like I saw an image today of I think it was happening at the Alberta border, where there's a number of people occupying that area. And I just saw this video of all those people that are occupying hugging the police, like going down the line and each of them hugging police. Well, where Indigenous people trying to protect their homelands, traditional territories are met with violence, tactics, aggressive tactics, even in locally for Six Nations, the 1492 land back lane, there was a lot of violence and weapons used in order to disperse Indigenous peoples from that. So I just wanted again to point that out as well. This was an art exhibit that was in Toronto. It's not there anymore, but it's by an artist named Jay Soul Chippewa. So I think you can see this on online. So there is a website down here called Built on Genocide, to bring that home, like there's been a lot of techniques used for Indigenous peoples, and Canada it essentially is guilty of genocide of Indigenous peoples. So genocide via the mass killings of buffalo, starvation, the Indian Act, theft of land and resources, residential schools. Here there's a quote or a number here of 35,000 kids at residential schools. The loss of languages, 100%. I don't know my language. I had a mom who lived at residential school for all of her childhood. And I tell this story often, but I remember when I was a child, my mom, she had a phone call from one of my aunts, her sister. And I remember hearing her speak in the language. And I was thinking, I never heard of her speak like that before. And I was just like in awe of this language that she was speaking, and I wanted to hear more. So after she got off the phone with my aunt, I asked her to say something to me in the language, and she got so angry at me, and she told me never ever to ask her to say something in the language again. And I was very young, so I didn't really understand why she said that or why she had the reaction that she did. But if you knew what happened at residential schools, that children were beaten and tortured for speaking their language, right? So it wasn't until I was older, obviously I was a pretty young kid, that I realized what had occurred. And so like I said, when I first started, I'm learning pieces of my language, and I want to try and reclaim that. And so learning different words and different terms every day. 60 scoop, but also acknowledging that the 60 scoop never actually ended, so it's still the millennial scoop. So there is the current apprehension of Indigenous children into foster care and being adopted. Forced sterilization is another one. You know, that's even still happening, right? There are young Indigenous girls that are being forced to take or be implanted with some sort of birth control device. So definitely 154 years of acts intended to destroy Indigenous people. That's definitely genocide. And then another part of the exhibit, so that was the buffalo, those are buffalo skulls. If you ever hear of Jay ever putting this exhibit back up, I would definitely recommend seeing it for sure, but it's not there anymore. Residential schools. So yes, I talked about it. So residential schools were documented as early as 1700s. In 1874, there was an official agreement between the government and several churches for the delivery of education or of Indian education. There was a major shift in the intentions of these institutions. So they did initially start off as meant to educate or meant to, I guess, like those industrial working, learning a trade for perhaps, but then it shifted to assimilation. The official agreement, the official government agreement was ended in 1969, but the last residential school closed in 1996, although I think there were other ones that weren't government or, government run that did still operate after 1996. But the last one that was operated by the government was Gordon Indian Residential School. And so there in residential school, there were medical practices, medical experiments that were conducted on health on nutrition and the health impacts of certain medical, I guess, medicines or different things. So there was the forced sterilization, the nutritional experiments. So like prolonged starvation, food supplements, trials of food supplements and medicines, or the withholding of medicines on children. And there were also psychological experiments. There was there was also a very famous residential school called St. Mary's that had the electric chair. If you ever get the chance to do, I think they have an online tour of the Mohawk Residential School, Mohawk Institute, the one closest to us in Brantford Six Nations. They talk about in the basement, one of the school heads had essentially what was a fight club and would get the boys' children to fight with each other. So there were documentation of that happening. So huge mental health and health impacts. So survivors of Indian residential schools have a higher rate of mental illness, post-traumatic stress disorder, major depression. And I definitely see that, you know, like with me growing up, you know, there was addictions in my family, mental health issues. So there are huge effects that even, you know, are passed down intergenerationally for sure. Substance abuse problems and things. So, I have some information too about the grave sites found. So the first one was Kamloops with 215 potential grave sites, Cowessess First Nation, Chippewa the Thames, which is really nearby, are just starting their search, and even Six Nations Mohawk Institute has made plans to begin their search as well. And so, and then those are the and then the other two that I mentioned. So the one that was just put out in the media 3 weeks ago, and then the one today. I wanted to talk about the Millennial Scoop too. I talked about it a little bit briefly earlier. So I just wanted to show these two images. So the first one, the one here where it says a child is waiting. So this was an adoption ad, right? And so this one was probably, it says June 197. So that was in the 70s. So children were scooped out of their homes, out of their communities, reserves, and put into predominantly white families all over the world, not just in Canada. And just to kind of bring this home too, here, I'll read this, right? So meet Bubbly Skyler. She's a female with First Nations background, animated and cheerful youngster bursting with life. Here, this sweet girl, Jenny, needs a forever home. 6-year-old Jenny is a young Aboriginal girl who is most in her element when she is in nature. Like, just look at the language around that. What are you thinking when you see, you know, the statement, this sweet girl, Jenny, needs a forever home? What does that sound like to you? If you wanted to shout it out, just, or put it in the chat, just even just think about how that sounds.
Someone said pet adoption.
Definitely 100% pet adoption. It's a pet adoption. It sounds like a pet adoption ad. And so this was actually, and I don't think I have the link to it, but this was something that was actually on the government of BC's website for fostering and adoption. And that happened in November 2017. You could Google it, I'm sure. I think there was a CBC article about it. But just like, it's back to the 60s and 70s, right, of those adoptions ads. And it's the constant dehumanizing of Indigenous peoples, the language around it. We're thought of as less than, right, less than human, less than people. There's other cases like Colton Bushy, right? Or there was another case in Hamilton And a lot, oftentimes, you know, it's that argument of protection of property. And so there's that thought of, like, as Indigenous people, we're less than property. Sorry, I'm just looking at the chat here. Yeah, it sounds like they will say anything to get a family to take the child in and don't see the child as who they are. Definitely devalued and dehumanized, for sure. Mm-hmm. So thank you for that comment. But definitely is, it's still happening today. And even the racism in medical, in medicine, right? Like healthcare, the death of Joyce Echelon in Quebec, right? So there's this huge, It's we're still not, you know, past these events. Okay, just checking the time. Wow, I have not gone through, I don't think, half my presentation. So I'm just going to talk as much as possible. If you have to leave at 7 o'clock, that's fine. Hopefully you can stay a little bit longer though. So I just wanted to go quickly around this slide and just listing a little bit about Indigenous laws. So here is a list of common Anishinaabe legal principles, because my presentation is supposed to be on the legal implications, I guess, or the legal side of and talking a little bit about Gladue, which I can. So yeah, you can look through that list of the legal principles. I have another one here on Haudenosaunee legal principles with a comparison of Eurocentric. So very patriarchal, whereas Haudenosaunee is more balanced. You know, there's that innocent until proven guilty. The crown must prove beyond a reasonable doubt. Whereas, you know, there's more of an individual responsibility and even a collective responsibility, right? So for legal criminal side, it's basically against the crown and the perpetrator of the crime, right? So it doesn't take a lot of consideration into the victim. And so with Indigenous and Haudenosaunee legal principles, it really does incorporate the victim and how to provide reparations to those that were harmed. So it's very based in restorative practices for sure. There's a lot of a lot more in our Eurocentric legal system that's very adversarial. It's based on punishment and jail, retribution. Whereas the Haudenosaunee really talks about restoring the balance and trying to get that balance back in order, I guess, or back into harmony. All right, I'm just going to talk I'm going to talk a little bit about GLADU. So what is GLADU? So essentially it is a remedy to the over-incarceration of Indigenous peoples by addressing the impacts and legacy of colonialism. And it is embedded in the criminal Code of Canada. So section 712.8E is really what talks about when GLADU is applied. So I'll just read this out. All available sanctions other than imprisonment that are reasonable in the and consistent with the harm done to victims or to the community, which should be considered for all offenders, with particular attention to the circumstances of Aboriginal offenders. So there were a couple of court cases that tried to use GLADU, or was the first kind of test cases for the application of GLADU principles. So the first one was R versus GLADU, and then R versus Wells, which clarified some points of GLADU, and then R versus Apili, which affirmed the court's previous two holdings or the first one of R versus GLADU. So I'll talk a little bit briefly about what the very first one is. So essentially there was an Indigenous woman named Jamie GLADU. She was a 19-year-old Cree woman living off reserve. So her mom was Cree, her father's side was Métis. So it was believed that she had believed that her common law husband was having an affair. So they ended up having a fight. And both being under the influence of alcohol, she was essentially deemed the aggressor, but he had provoked her. She confronted her husband about the affair and he called her names. So she ended up stabbing him, which led to his death. There was a history of domestic violence between Jamie and her common law husband, including while she was pregnant. She was pregnant at the time of the offense with her second child. And so there was also historical issues around being impaired. So there was breaches of conditions with alcohol use. So the trial judge in this case had said that GLADU was not a battered or fearful wife, GLADU had an undiagnosed hypothyroid condition resulting in that erratic behavior. Bail was granted to her, but she was sentenced to 3 years in prison. The sentencing judge said there were no special circumstances arising from her Indigenous status. So it was thought that that was kind of an error in judgments, because the trial judge noted that both the appellant, meaning GLADU, and the deceased were Indigenous, but since they were living in an urban area off reserve and not within the Aboriginal community as such, he found that there was no special circumstances arising from her status, so that he should take into consideration. So in this case, there was no submissions made in the sentencing hearing on the issue of the appellant's Indigenous heritage. And it was actually the trial judge who had asked if GLADU was Aboriginal, so the defense never even asked that question. So that was the first case. And so it kind of started off a little bit rocky, I suppose, because there were things that were supposed to happen, right? Like or that wasn't really affirmed, like what does it mean to be in an Indigenous home, I guess, or like living where you're living, do you have to live on reserve? And so the following court cases really affirmed that, you know, like, okay, so you don't have to live on reserve to be considered, you know, to consider the Gludu principles. The R versus Wells and Apili really dug into it a little bit further. And so if Gladue principles are not brought up in a case, that could be considered grounds for a new trial. I know that was very technical and legal, so I'll go into a little bit more of what actual Gladue factors are. So I have a list here of what Gladue factors are, or what are considered Gladue factors. So essentially there may be a report written for an Indigenous person who is in the criminal context. So things like cultural and spiritual identity, treaties or communities that they're involved in or associated with, poverty, substance abuse, mental health, domestic violence, individual, family, and community breakdown, dislocation and fragmentation, racism, unemployment, low income, or lack of opportunity, their experience or intergenerational experience of Indian residential schools, day schools, hospitals, the 60 scoop, millennial scoop, etc. I'm just gonna pass that. Judicial notice just means that lawyers don't have to prove that things like residential school are harmful from Indigenous people. So it's just a judicial notice just means it's a known fact, like in nighttime at midnight, it's dark kind of thing. So when is Gladue applied in the criminal context? So it applies to all situations where an Indigenous person's liberty is at stake. So anytime that they're facing a loss of liberty or loss of, I guess, freedom, I suppose. So in bail, in sentencing and parole eligibility, legally they need to apply it. So that's section 718.2E. However, Gladue can be used in other areas. So I don't work in the criminal context. So my area and Waterloo Region Community Legal Services more works in tribunal work. So in other areas, so I use Gladue to address overrepresentation in other areas of law that the ones that we work in, so like disability, ODSP or CPPD, housing and employment. And then using Gladue is essentially to help Indigenous people heal through a process and our system by validating and honoring Indigenous experiences, teachings, customs, and practices, and to reduce and eliminate barriers to Indigenous peoples who are in conflict with various areas of law. So, like I said, we cover areas of social assistance. So ODSP has been, I have used, or colleagues of mine have used Gladue in appeal cases for ODSP. So when somebody has been denied and they've appealed that. So with ODSP, a person has to meet the definition of a person with disability, but the adjudicator must consider the whole person. And so a Gladue would be very useful in that sense where, you know, taking into consideration the whole person. So what has occurred in their past, right, to get to the point where they're at now, like perhaps, you know, suffering from PTSD or mental health issues, right, addictions, and how those Gladue factors have contributed to all of those. The LTB is another one that it's been used in. So in an eviction proceeding, right? So what is an alternative to eviction? When the LTB is provided with a Gladue brief, so Gladue brief versus Gladue reports. In my context, I use briefs as opposed to reports because reports is more used in the criminal context. But where the LTB is provided with a Gladue brief, which touched on matters relevant to issues before them, they would have to consider that as evidence as it relates to the grounds for eviction. So then the adjudicator at the LTB could consider the remedies that is appropriate other than eviction, right? To address the factors, the Gladue factors that account for a breach in the Residential Tenancies Act. Gladue recommendations. So the recommendations are a huge component of a Gladue report or a Gladue brief, and it is made for the benefit of the client. We use a client-centered approach, seeking to balance the application of Indigenous and colonial law. In accordance with the client's nation's traditional teachings, customs, and practices. So oftentimes in a Gladue document, interviewing of elders and knowledge carriers within their communities and interviewing of other supports that they may have or family members even. But it is meant to support the client's culture and spiritual development as a means of holistic healing. And so its intention is to help that individual better manage conflict, prevent future conflict with systems. And then it also includes a restorative justice plan. And just talking about restorative justice, so four key values of a restorative approach. So providing safe space for the harmer and community to come together and talk about the harm and repercussions it caused, making amends, so having the harmer fix and provide reparation for the harm they caused for the victim and people that are have been impacted as well. So it might not just be one person that was impacted, but a whole entire family or community. Reintegration, bringing the harmed and the harmer back into a state of balance, and inclusion, creating a place, space, and opportunity for all those impacted by the crime to play a role in the resolution and a way forward. And just as a disclaimer too, not all incidences or not all harms can be addressed in a restorative justice approach. It really has to include all members. So like someone that was harmed, if they're not willing to be part of a restorative approach, then it wouldn't be advisable to go, enter into a restorative process, or if there's the thought that it could create further harm. Gladue going forward. So the community legal clinics aim to provide Gladue services to accomplish three objectives: to validate the experiences of Indigenous peoples, recognize that experience of Indigenous peoples are applicable beyond the scope of criminal law. So like I said, applying it to ODSP or LTB, but even other areas, right? Like there's a ton of areas of law, and I know there's things like immigration. I heard recently that was, Gladue was applied. And number three, support and validate the experience of Indigenous people who are recognized as relevant and admissible evidence in administrative applications, so our clinic areas of law and appeal process. Also too, another thing, like for example, with ODSP, it's very Western medical focused. So a lot of the ODSP applications really rely on the doctor's report if that individual is considered disabled. And so there's still a lot of work ahead, but trying to kind of change that narrative of it doesn't always have to be the doctor that can validate a person's disability. So a lot of the advocacy that I do is, looking at that whole person or those alternatives, even in healthcare, the reasons why an Indigenous person would be not wanting to disclose medical information to their doctor, that the fear of racism, of stigma, And there are tons of people that I come into contact with that have experienced the racism and discrimination within the healthcare system, all systems actually, but healthcare system in this context. I use a trauma-informed practice. So the purpose of writing a Gladue report is to basically help the individual, right, to help them avoid being caught up in systems. And so I to do a GLIDU report or a GLIDU brief to ensure that, you know, they're not going to be further harmed and that there is a process that they can use to heal from it. So I do use that trauma-informed practice to help that individual. Colonial trauma, so like the implications of colonial trauma and the losses, I kind of talked about that earlier. I think I'm going to leave it there because we are over time. How's everybody feeling right now? Like, is there any questions, any discussion that people want to talk about? I know I have a few other slides, but I know we're over time, so.
Someone was commenting that the process is very demeaning.
Sorry, which process?
I think you were talking about the ODSP when they messaged.
Oh, 100%. Yeah, it can be very demeaning. And it's not, you know, trying to prove a disability to get money, right? Like, it's you can see why people wouldn't want to, you know, disclose, you know, medical issues too. I mean, I can think of like, just thinking of like off the top of my head, a mother, right, with children, if they were to disclose mental health issues, like what's the fear there, right? Like, is their child going to be apprehended? So definitely it could be so demeaning, and it is. I want to focus too a little bit on allyship. So allyship and being an ally. So here are some points of, you know, how to be an ally. So building the relationships with Indigenous peoples, learning about oppression and privilege, learning about your own privilege, and how kind of your social location, right? I know as social workers, we talk a lot about our social location. So I mean, as an Indigenous person, I personally do have privileges, right? Like, I'm lighter skinned than some Indigenous people. So I can pass in certain groups, right? As being non-Indigenous. I'm able-bodied, right? Like I work full-time, I'm able to, you know, get up and move around. So I do recognize that I have those privileges myself. Third point, learn about the history and colonization from the perspective of Indigenous peoples. Learn about the people you are working with, being accountable, and challenging larger oppressive power structures. Advocating for policy changes, right? And like, if you have a workplace, advocate for smudging in your workplace, for example, or look at the policies. How are policies, you know, work against Indigenous and marginalized peoples? And yeah, I think I'm going to stop it there. So if anybody has any questions. I see a couple of, all right. I just see, thank you. So thank you so much, everyone, for listening to my presentation. If you have any questions, feel free to shout them out or put them in the chat. I'll be here for a couple more minutes longer. I'm gonna put my email in the chat. So if anybody wants to follow up, if they have any questions, feel free to email me.
I'm going to stop the recording in case anybody would like to unmute and ask questions.